talk to you today about being a good citizen. The reason I wrote this book, We the Children of India, is because I believe that it's important to be a good citizen. And it has been said that that's the most important post in the country, a good citizen. Even more important than being the President of India. Because if you have many good citizens, then you can have a wonderful country. So now, why are we, how do we become good citizens and why are we not all good citizens? I think one of the reasons is that, first of all, to be a good citizen, you must know what the Constitution is about. And the preamble to the Constitution, though we have one of the longest constitutions in the world, the preamble, which is the beginning of the Constitution, gives you the essence. And if you know the preamble, then you have the spirit of the Constitution in simple English so that you understand it and that you can feel that you know what it involves. And amongst the important words in the preamble, we have the words justice, we have the word equality, we have the word liberty, and we have the word fraternity. These are the very important words in the Constitution, apart from the fact that we are a republic and that we are a sovereign republic. And then two other words were introduced later, which is socialist and secular. So now, let's see, do you know what a republic means? A republic is when the people of the country rule the country, and when you have a democratic republic, then it's government of the people, by the people, for the people. That means you could have a democracy in your school, which would be, you could rule the school by yourselves. You could elect the people you want, because all of you can't sit and, you know, manage things, so you can decide whom you want to become your representatives, and you can do it for your betterment. Similarly, what does the word liberty mean? It means you're free. But when you're, that's what he said, it means when you're free. It's right that when you're free, you don't have absolute freedom. Why don't you have absolute freedom? Because you are free, you say, I'm free, I can slap you. You can slap the boy next to you. But that's not real freedom, because he's also free. Of course, if he was free, you will slap him and he'll slap you back. And that's not what we want. So you're free, but you're free in a limited way, free to do the things that you want to do, respecting his rights. You're free to have friends, you're free to go to a particular school, you're free to have a group, you're free to eat what you like, apart from what your parents tell you, and things like that. You have a certain freedom, but you have a certain limitation in that freedom. And that limitation is dependent on the rights of others. So that's why, though you're free, you have to. So that is liberty, and liberty is very important. Then you come to the word justice. What does justice mean? Justice basically is to be fair. Even at home, if your mother gives you less food than your brother, though you're both the same age, about the same age, then you'll say to her, Mama, be fair. You say to her, be fair. Be fair means be just. And we have it every day in your lives at home. If a girl is given less and a boy is given more, that's not fair. So that's not just. And that's the kind of justice we have to see. So that's the meaning of justice. I'm going to explain the words to you very simply, then we'll talk about other things. What is the meaning of equality?
Everybody should be treated equally.
Yeah, you're right. That's equality. But when you say everybody should be treated equally, suppose you are educated in a good school and there's another person who is not your age, who's not educated at all. Now, how can you treat them equally?
Ma'am, they should be treated as well as the educated one.
Yeah, that's true. You can't treat unequals as equal. Yes. So we have to try and make all the unequals become equal. So we have to make an attempt to try and educate everybody so that they become equal and then we can treat them equally. But till they become equal, you can't treat them equally. I'm going to ask you a question. You listen carefully, and then you can raise your hands as I tell you. But every answer that you give, everybody's answers are right. It's only a question of looking at it. There is one bamboo flute, and there are three children. And the first child says, give the flute to me, I made it. And the second child says, give the flute to me, I can play it well. And the third child says, give the flute to me, I have no other toys. Now, those of you who will give the flute to the person who made it, raise your hands. Those of you who will give the flute to the child who can play it well, raise your hands. And those of you who will give the flute to the child who has no toys, raise your hands. Okay. So now I see that almost all of you raise your hands for the last proposition. That is the child who has no toys. So this is because in a country like India, there are so many children who have no toys. So it's good to give it to the child who has no toys, because that child will learn to make it, that child will learn to play it, that child will be fully focused on it, because they have no other toys. But in many countries, it's not like that. That is just, that is also just. And in a country like ours, that is social justice, so it's very important. But in a country like, in many American places, you ask American children, and they say, give it to the child who made it. Because they find property rights are very strong. They think, he's made it, he should have it. Of course, it's a bamboo flute, so there is not much cost of the original item. But the fact is that in a country like India, the third proposition is just. Whereas it depends, therefore, when you do justice, you have to look around you and see what is actual real justice. So, and in European countries, many people say, give it to the child who plays it well, because they're very strong on merit. Now, I asked my granddaughter, she was 8 years old, asked her the same question. And she put up her, she told me, give it to the child who has no toys. And I said to her, you know, I'm a judge, or I was a judge, and you can't give a decision or can't take a decision without giving reasons. So you must tell me why. Why should I give it to the child who has no toys? And I hadn't thought, she thought about it, and she said to me, the child who made it knows how to make it, and he can make another. He can just get the bamboo and make another. The child who knows how to play it well already must have a flute or must have access to a flute. Otherwise, how does he or she know how to play it well? But the child who has no toys will really value it. When I was your age, India was not a free country. They were the British that were ruling us, and they had come first as traders to do business here, and then they stayed on as rulers. And then they decided what we should, where we could go, what kind of jobs we could have. So though it was our country, Indians were not able to decide the rules of the game. 15th of August, we got our independence in 1947. There's another day which is very special, and that is the day we got our constitution. Our constitution took about 3 years to write. And there were a group of people who got together to write this constitution. They would have meetings, and everything done was done democratically. So every item, whether we should have a president, whether we should have a governor, how many people, what is the way of voting into parliament, all these things were decided by voting at each stage of the discussion. And you decide. Now you have something called secret voting, and you have something which is open voting. Open voting is easy. You want to decide who's to play, shall we play basketball or shall we play badminton? You can have open voting because there's no real problem. But if you want to decide who should be the captain of your school, maybe you should have secret voting, because your best friend might tell you, vote for me, and you might think that he's not the best person to be the captain. But you don't want to say it openly to him, because he may not remain your best friend. So you go for secret voting and do what you think is right. Those of you who have seen my book will see that after the constitution was ready, it had to be signed. And it was to sign by all the people of the members of the, what they call the Constituent Assembly, because they all came together to decide what the constitution should be about. And the president normally is the head of the government, and he should sign first. But Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was our first prime minister, and he was so excited about the constitution that he went and signed it first. So the president who went after him didn't find any place to sign, because he was written right at the top, and then he went and signed it above him, all Tera Mera. You'll see it in the book. And those of you who have seen the book will open that page and see that he signed it right above Jawaharlal Nehru, but all in a slant, because he had to squeeze his signature in. So you see, even people like big important people like prime ministers and presidents do these kind of things. So you see, but you have to be conscious of what you're doing, and so that, and always remember that if you make a mistake, it's not the end of the world. You can correct your mistake, you can change things, and you can acknowledge your mistake. So that's being a good citizen. You can acknowledge your mistakes. And I'll tell you a story. You know, a man who was dying, and he had three children, and he wanted to see which of his children knew how to innovate. And he said to his children, give each of them 1,000 rupees. And he said to them, you can buy anything you want with this money. The only thing is, the only condition is, that what you buy must fill this room. So the first child went out and bought, what would you think? Bought grass. He brought grass for 1,000 rupees, and he thought, a lot of grass. So he brought it, but it didn't fill the room. And the second child went and bought cotton, and he took it to the man who fluffs the cotton, had it fluffed out, and brought it and tried to fill the room. And even the fluffed cotton didn't fill the room. And the third child went and bought an earthen lamp, a diya, an earthen lamp for 10 rupees. He brought it, he put a little oil in it, and put a wick, and he brought it to the room, and he lit it. And the light of that lamp filled the whole room. So he had 990 rupees in his pocket, and with 10 rupees he had done the job, and he had filled the room. So you have to innovate, you have to think of new ways how to do things. So it's very important to innovate, and that's the way you can help to make things happen. The other thing to be, when you're a good citizen, you know, you have to be courageous. You have to, if somebody else is being treated badly, you have to stand up and say, you can't treat the person badly. It's your duty to do that. Not only if you're being treated badly. If you see someone being beaten, then you must try and stop that person. Because that is your duty to do that. Because if someone beats you, then no one will stop. Because they will say you never stopped, or there will be no one to stop. And there is a saying in the law courts that when they came to arrest, you know what arrest is? Yeah? When the police come to arrest you or take you away to jail. When they came to arrest the person wrongfully on the right of me, I didn't protest. And when they came to arrest the person on the left of me wrongfully, I didn't protest. So when they came to arrest me wrongfully, there was no one to protest to. So it's very important that you should be strong, and you should be courageous, and you should take steps to ensure that there's justice done to everybody, not just to yourself. That's a very important aspect. The other thing is, you know, you sometimes feel that you're doing something which is right, and that no one else is joining you, and others are doing things in a bad way, and they're not listening, or that there are not willing to join those who are doing things correctly. So you feel despondent. You feel, oh, what's the point? I'm doing it alone. Nobody else is bothering. They're all doing their own things and doing bad things. But you know, the thing is, you must never give up. That's very important. You know, there's a song in Bengali, which was written by Tagore, which says, Akla Cholo Re. It means, Akla, it's the song says, Akla Cholo, Akla Cholo, Akla Cholo Re. Jodi Dak Shune Kina Ashe, Tabe Akla Cholo Re. It means, walk alone when you're doing something right, if you think it's right. And call the others, but if they don't come, continue to walk alone. And those of you who know about Gandhiji and know that he did something called the Salt March, do you know about the Salt March? Yes? Yeah. So he started alone and hundreds of people joined him. And the salt, and he went to the sea and he took the water from the sea and he got the salt from there and he told people, this is the salt you should eat and don't buy the salt in the market because the British government is trying to tax it. And that was the beginning of the end of the British government. In Japan, there was an island. And on that island, there were monkeys. People who were experimenting, they were throwing sweet potatoes. You know what sweet potatoes are? Shakarkandi, huh? Sweet potatoes onto that island. And the monkeys were picking up the sweet potatoes. They were covered in sand and eating them. And they were eating them because they liked them or because they were hungry and they ate the sweet potatoes. And one day, one little female monkey called Emu, she was just 18 months old, she took the sweet potato to a stream nearby and she washed it. And she ate it and it tasted so much nicer. And she went back and told her mother, and her mother also tried it, and her mother liked it, and they found, and she told her friends, and her friends told their mothers, and then they found that those people who were children started eating the sweet potato after washing it. But the older people who didn't have children or who were not being converted by them were still eating the sweet potato with the sand. But when the 100th monkey, 100 is just a number, when a large number of monkeys started eating sweet potatoes after washing them, all the monkeys went to the water and washed their sweet potatoes. So if you have an idea and if it's good, you start with one, you can convert your parents, because they're the easiest people to convert, and you convert your parents and you can convert your friends, and then you find that everybody realizes that this is a wonderful thing to do, and then they all do it. It's called tipping the balance. You've tipped the balance in favor of an idea. So that's how you do these things as a good citizen. So if you want this country to be a great country, you know, you have the freedom to dream. And you have to see what you want it to be, say, when you are grown up, when you are married, when you have children. What do you want to leave for your children? What kind of country do you want for your children? And you have to think about that. What is wonderful? So you go to other countries, you travel, and you see things and say, oh, this is good, they're very clean, the streets are clean, there are no poor people. Everybody can't be the same, but there's nobody who is starving. There are people everybody has education, everybody has clothes. So these are the things you want. And then you want a nice environment. You don't want a polluted environment. You don't want that you're going to be coughing all the time because all the dust is going into your chest. So you have to make sure that you do those things from now and get your parents to do those things from now. So we'll end with reading the poem, which you're going to recite after me. Let's be equal, just and free.
Let's be equal, just and free.
Strong in our diversity.
Strong in our diversity.
Free in thought.
Free in thought.
And free in prayer.
Free to dream and free to dare.
Free to dream and free to dare. Free to love and free to care.
Free to love and free to care.
Let's be equal, just and free.
Let's be equal, just and free.
Strong in our diversity.
Strong in our diversity.
Let's be equal, free and just.
Let's be equal, free and just.
unified in love and trust. Strong to lend the weaker hand. Strong to help and understand. Strong to build a happier land. Let's be equal, free and just. Unified in love and trust. Thank you. Now you can ask me questions.
Ma'am,
yes.
By any chance did you meet Mahatma Gandhi?
Have I met him? Yes, I met him once. But met him, I was a child and he was giving a talk, and so I could say I met him in that sense. I can't say that I actually had a conversation with him.
Okay.
But I did see him. Because for us, when I was a child, my icon was Mahatma Gandhi and Pandit Nehru. They were my icons. Like your icons today, I don't know who your icons are. But maybe Bill Gates or someone, I don't know who you consider your icons, but our icons were those.
Did you see any war?
Yes, the 1939 war was on. I was 9 years old, and I remember that things were being sold in the black market, and we were never allowed to buy, and lots of my friends were getting sugar from the black market, and we were not allowed to buy because we were told we are fighting the war. I said, how can we fight the war? We are children, how do we fight the war? They said, you fight the war by not buying in the black market.
In which year did you start writing the books?
In which year did I?
Start writing the books.
Did I start writing these books? After I retired, I wrote my autobiography when I was 73. And I wrote this book in 2010. When I was 80, so that's it.
Where did this idea come from?
Well, the idea came because I felt that in schools, they don't teach religion anymore because we are a secular country. And only in religious schools they teach religion. So I felt that there was no morality being taught, no kind of ethics being taught in schools. So I felt that if not religion, we should have constitutional morality. So I wrote this book hoping that children will learn the ethics, the constitution, what it teaches you. And that's what was very important. That's where the idea came from.
How many total rules do you have in India? We have in India.
I don't know. Impossible. Impossible. And every day they're making new rules and not getting rid of the old ones. It's an impossible question to answer. Too many. Yeah.
Excuse me, ma'am, from all the six fundamental rights, which one do you value the most?
Which is the most important one?
Yes, ma'am, for you, like a personal opinion, ma'am, from the six fundamental rights.
I think all the fundamental rights are important. They're very important. Not to have liberty is not a good thing. Not to have justice is also very important. So all of them are important, I think. Fundamental duties also are important. They have come in later, but they're very important. Yes, now.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, I guess we all know that India is one of the countries where women are not given so many rights compared to men. Ma'am, being the first women judge of India, how do you feel?
Actually, I'm not the first woman judge of India. I was the first judge in Delhi High Court. There was a woman who was a judge in Kerala before me, about 8 or 10 years earlier. But I'll say this, I think that by our constitution, women have equal rights. And also there's a clause in our constitution which allows women to have laws to be made to give women special rights, to try and make us equal. As I was saying earlier, you can't treat unequals as equals. So to make us equal, there are certain, the constitution provides that we can make laws to make us equal or give us reservation. And I think we are slowly getting there. Very slowly, but we are getting there.
Ma'am, which was your most difficult judgment till now?
That's a difficult question because there are many, many judgments that are difficult. And sometimes they're difficult because they're difficult to deal with on a larger scale because it involves, say, many people. And sometimes it's very difficult because they involve families, like they involve a child. Should the child go to the mother? Should the child be given to the father? The mother and father divorce or separate? those are also very difficult decisions. So it's very difficult to say what was the most difficult case. There were many.
Ma'am, allow me to give a bit of a background to my question.
Yes.
Just started reading your autobiography and also reading this interview by Indira Nui, CEO PepsiCo. And she says that she's talking about her struggles in her career, and she says women really can't have it all. And she drew a lot of flack for the press for saying that. Laura Barkadat and Vinita Daura Nangi, and they really pulled her down and calling her ideas and opinions as regressive and discouraging. And I've been reading about you and also talking to friends around, and you have many firsts to your name. Apart from that, you have raised 3 children who are doing extremely well in the respective fields that I've chosen. And even though it may not count as an accomplishment, I think today's world, having a steady married life is also an accomplishment by itself. What do you think, ma'am? Can women really not have it all?
Of course, women can reach the top. It's a question of having to balance. If you want to have a full life, then you don't want to miss out on marriage and children. Because I think that it rounds you in every way to have marriage, to have children, and to have a profession. On the other hand, if you are only a professional, also you can be complete in yourself. But for me, I felt that I wanted marriage as well. And I'll say this, that the one qualification to be successful with a marriage and a profession is you should have a supportive husband. Because if you don't have a supportive husband, then there's too much tension in the house every day with it. And I was very lucky in my generation, women weren't working, and my husband was extremely supportive. And I remember once I had a case on, and there was some problem, and there was something to be done in the house, and there was a little, let us say, a little bit of kitpit between us. And then I said to my husband, I said, well, if you want, I'll give up the profession. I was unhappy, but I said that. And he said, I can never ask you to do that. It's like your 2 hands. I can't ask you to cut off 1 hand. He was extremely supportive in that way. And I think that's partly why I could achieve both success in my profession and success in my home also.
So are you retired from your...
Yeah, that's a good question. I actually retired from the court in 22 years ago. Okay. But then I went on to the Law Commission, and then I went on to do other things. And now I'm writing a book again. So you could say I'm retired, but I am not retired. And I think when I retire, when I die, because I enjoy doing work, and that keeps me young.
Ma'am, my question is, ma'am, was it your dream to learn law, or you are inspired by something to learn?
Well, my mother, you know, my father died when I was 11 years old. So my mother had a very difficult time to bring us up. There was no money. She was not educated enough to have a job. So she had a very difficult time. But she said whatever she did, she kept educating us somehow, through friends' help, through other people's help. And she told me the most important thing is to learn and to be educated, because then nobody can take it away from you.